Hello everyone, this is our fourth video about antihypertensive medications. In this video, we're going to discuss the direct acting vasodilators, which include two medications. They are hydralazine and minoxidil. I hope all is ready. Now let's get started. Direct acting vasodilators are medications that act by dilating the resistant arterioles. And by dilating the resistant arterioles, we are reducing the systemic vascular resistance. Or in other words, we are decreasing the afterload. Because the afterload is dependent on the systemic vascular resistance. Reducing the systemic vascular resistance reduces the afterload or the blood pressure. These medications do not have a dilating effect on the venous side of the circulation, so they do not affect the venous return to the heart, or in other words, they do not affect the preload. We have two medications in this class. We have hydralazine and we have minoxidil. Hydralazine can be used orally or parenterally for hypertension. Minoxidil is actually used topically for male pattern baldness. It's not commonly used as antihypertensive. You can use it, but it's not common. The most common use is topically for male pattern baldness. The problem with these medications is they cause reflex tachycardia because they do not affect the reflex sympathetic surge. And the reflex tachycardia can elicit angina symptoms, especially in patients with ischemic heart disease. And that's, of course, if they're used alone. Another problem with these medications, because of this reflex sympathetic surge, they can increase the renin and sodium retention. Remember, we said the juxtaglomerular cells of the kidney have beta-1 receptors. And stimulation of these beta-1 receptors can increase the renin secretion. And the renin can increase the renin-angiotensin-aldosterone system, can increase the blood pressure and sodium retention. So you are basically doing the opposite of what you are aiming to do. In order to counteract these two problems, we have to combine these medications with two other agents. The first is a beta blocker to blunt this reflex tachycardia and increase in the renin secretion, and also a diuretic to counteract the sodium retention. The exact mechanism of action of hydralazine is not clearly understood. But we have three proposed mechanisms. The first one is the stimulation of nitric oxide release from the vascular endothelium. Usually nitric oxide comes from the vascular endothelium. This increase in the nitric oxide release will result in the stimulation of the guanyl cyclase enzyme, which stimulates the production of intracellular levels of cyclic GMP. So intracellular levels of cyclic GMP increases. When the intracellular levels of cyclic GMP increases, this stimulates protein phosphatases. And when these protein phosphatases become stimulated, it dephosphorylates micelle light chains. And when micelle light chains becomes dephosphorylated, it detaches from actin, and so this will result eventually into smooth muscle relaxation. Another proposed mechanism is the opening of potassium channels. And this will result in hyperpolarization of the vascular smooth muscle cells and smooth muscle relaxation. Finally, hydralazine can block the IP3 or inositol 3-phosphate dependent release of calcium from the smooth muscle sarcoplasmic reticulum. This is a long process, I don't want to go into details, but this IP3, which comes from the cell membrane, stimulates the release of calcium from the sarcoplasmic reticulum. And as we all know, calcium stimulates smooth muscle contraction. So by impairing the release of calcium from the sarcoplasmic reticulum, we are impairing smooth muscle contraction. Hydralazine uses includes hypertension. And as we discussed earlier, you have to combine it with a diuretic and beta blocker to block the reflex tachycardia and the renin secretion and sodium retention. And that's why this is not really a first line. Another important use of hydralazine is congestive heart failure. And the most important point you need to know is that it has to be combined with isosorbide dinitrate for better results. Both medications dilate the blood vessels and make it easier for the heart to pump the blood. This combination is especially effective in the African American population. So these are the high yield points. You have to combine it with isosorbide dinitrate, and this is important in African-American population. Also, hydralazine use is safe during pregnancy, and that's why it's one of the medications that can be used in hypertension in pregnancy. There is a mnemonic that can be used to remember those medications. Hypertensive moms love nifedipine. Hyper for hydralazine, MUM-M for methyl-DOPA, LOVE-L for labetalol, nifedipine is nifedipine. Side effects of hydralazine includes headache, flushing, reflex tachycardia, palpitations, and this is all because of the decrease in the blood pressure or hypotension. Also, the reflex tachycardia can induce anginal symptoms, especially in patients with ischemic heart disease. You have to be cautious in using hydralazine with other antihypertensive medications or vasodilators because this will induce severe hypotension. For the same reason, alcohol by itself causes hypotension. So when combining alcohol with hydralazine, you can induce severe hypotension. Finally, hydralazine can cause something called drug-induced lupus. And this is especially important in patients who are slow acetylators. Slow acetylators metabolize hydralazine more slowly. So this exposes the body to more time with the toxic metabolites of hydralazine, and this can result in drug-induced lupus. There is a mnemonic that you guys can use to remember the medications that can cause drug-induced lupus. Before I say this mnemonic, you have to memorize that drug-induced lupus is characterized by positive antihistone antibodies in the serum. This is very characteristic of drug-induced lupus. And the mnemonic is SHIP, S-H-I-P-P-E-D. S stands for sulfa drugs like sulfasalazine and sulfamethoxazole. H stands for hydralazine. I stands for isoniazide. P stands for procainamide. Another P stands for phenytoin. E stands for etanercept, which is a medication used in patients with rheumatoid arthritis. And finally, D stands for deltiazem, which is a calcium channel blocker. Finally, I'm just going to say a few words about the drug minoxidil. This is a drug that can be used topically to treat male pattern baldness. It can be used also to treat resistant hypertension in combination with other medications like diuretic and beta blocker, just as we said in the case of hydralazine. It causes opening of the potassium channels, leading to hyperpolarization of the cell membranes and smooth muscle relaxation, also just as we said with hydralazine. Its effect on the hair growth is not really fully understood. The problem with minoxidil, especially in females, that it can cause excessive hair growth or what's called hirsutism. This is the end of the video. Thank you all for watching. In the next video, we're going to discuss sodium nitroprusside and phenoldopan. Thank you again for watching. Please don't forget to subscribe and also check our Facebook page. See you next time.